concessions to the American way of road racing will be the rolling start. In Europe, it's a grid start. And the field of 30 is now behind the pace car with Dan Gurney and the Olsenite Eagle on the pole, flanked by Jim Clark of Scotland in the Spear X Special, one of Rollo Vollstedt's cars. Bobby Unser and John Surtees make up the second row, and A.J. Foyt in a Sheraton Thompson Special shares the third row with Mario Andretti in the Dean Van Line Special. Roger McCluskey is seventh in the G.C. Murphy Special, and Ronnie Bucknam is eighth in the Vita Fresh Orange Juice Special. Gordon John Cock in his Gilmore Broadcasting Special and Jerry Grant in the Friedkin Eagle make up the first 10 starters, all of them with Ford Power out behind. Now, as they come off turn nine, down for the green flag, hopefully, the field is ready to get underway. There's the flag, and the race is on. Heading for that tricky turn one, Gurney out-accelerates Clark and sets the pace going up the hill to turn two. As the field sorts itself out, this is the testy part of the race, the first lap, sorting out after the start. Gurney leads out of two, Clark right behind, as expected. Third place is Bobby Unser, and fourth is John Surtees. Through the S's. And now Gurney starts to pull away as he approaches turn six. Clark about two lengths behind. One of the tough corners, huh, Roger?
It certainly is. You go uphill and into a very tight right-hander.
Clark is putting a pressure on Gurney. He's not letting him pull away. Gurney's a big man for road racing. These cars weigh only 1,350 pounds, and there's Lloyd Ruby parked the wrong way. A tough break for Ruby. And now Clark takes a run on Gurney down the straightaway, but can't make it. And into turn nine. That's an awfully hard wall on the outside. It's lined with steel boilerplate.
Looks like he's going to make a move there, and in fact, he is pulled almost even. But Gurney seems to out-accelerate him just a little bit as they approach turn one.
Well, Gurney, who really knows this course, he's won four 500-mile stock car races on this track and started racing here at Riverside. Now putting a little distance on Clark. Bobby Unser lies third in car number six. Twisting back and forth. Notice on Clark's car, there's a piece of metal over the exhaust pipes. That's an improvised spoiler. And there, what happened to Unser, Roger?
Well, he probably went in that turn a little bit too hard. Use it
for the race if he needs it. Dan Gurney still sets the pace in his Olsenite Eagle. And Clark right behind.
Out of turn nine, toward the start.
At Riverside with Dan Gurney still leading Jim Clark by the narrowest of margins in this 300-mile contest. It's been a close battle for the lead. A lot of rain here has left a lake in the infield of turn nine, and Clark comes off that turn still putting the pressure on the top. And there's Gurney off the road. What do you think happened, Roger?
Well, there's a little oil out there, Chris, and probably he was trying just a little too hard.
He got back on right away, though, and that, of course, gave Jim Clark the lead, and the fans are jumping now. Clark out in front, Gurney now in second place, trying to play catch-up. Around the corner, the protagonist for the championship, Mario Andretti, number one, A.J. Foyt, number 14, and Jerry Grant splitting the action there. Uh-oh, Clark's car appears to be smoking, and Gurney is going back into the lead. Oh, what an automobile race we've got here at Riverside today. Gurney off the road, out of the lead, and then Clark having mechanical trouble putting Gurney back into the number one position. Tough break for both, but more tough for Jim Clark. And it looks like oil down there, Roger.
Well, there certainly is. Some of that could be coming from... Here comes Clark into the pits. Let's see what his trouble is.
A tough break for the Scotsman who won the 1965 Indianapolis 500. He's got a lot of fans here in the United States. Rollo Vollstedt, the owner, goes over to ask him. And now they're looking the car over.
He doesn't appear to be getting out, so perhaps it's something minor that they could fix.
Well, we certainly hope so. Checking the engine over. Of course, the smoke was an indication that the problem did come from within the engine. Clark looks a little disappointed. Out of the car. We're going over to see if we can't get a word with him. Lots of action on that one lap. Jimmy, what all happened?
Well, we went into it as usual. There's a lot of oil around, and got to the end of the S's, and Dan went straight off before we got to turn six up the bank, and I got through all right in the lead, and stuck him out of six. I noticed the engine wasn't on eight, so I just had to keep on going anyway, and I was well clear of Dan by this time, but it just wasn't running, you know. So I did one more lap and came in.
Thank you. sense of accomplishment and satisfaction when we finally heard it running. And then when we had an opportunity to actually drive it for the first time under its own power, it was just such a mix of emotions in there that I had in the back of my mind, someday I'd like to go race at the Indy 500. I mean, it was one of those, you know, childhood dreams that I never really gave up on. And I heard about the historic Indy and Champ Car Racing Association. They do these exhibitions at some of these events, and some of the guys that were my heroes as a kid growing up would go out and do some of the exhibitions in one of their old cars there. And I thought, well, I couldn't race with them at the time. I'm too old now and they're not competing, but I still might have a chance to go out on track.
It's an honor bestowed upon very few. Since 1911, only 581 have earned the right to challenge her. Only 53 can claim success. She only accepts the challenge once a year, so annually they return. She is the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, and they are the 33 men who have earned the right to make the challenge this year. For 3 weeks, they have worked, and now wait for the four special words that will signal the beginning of their quest. It's race day in Indianapolis.
In company with the first lady ever to qualify at Indianapolis, gentlemen, start your engine.
Experience. Michael McKinney, McKinney Motorsports, restored this late 60s Vollstedt 4-cam Ford and invited me to drive it. My father had driven it. I gave it its best finish in 68 at Mont Tremblant behind Mario Andretti for second.
Cannon keeps up his charge. John Cannon has passed Mario and Al is moving up in fourth.
Cars famous for Jimmy Clark in the Rex Mays race, late 67. Spectacular car, what a sound. I forgot my earplugs the first run. I'll be deaf for muds, but what a glorious sound. And, oh, There's no downforce in those things, no drag. And you put your foot up it, they accelerate. Let me tell you, it's impressive. How these guys drove these things for 500 miles, I have no idea. Well, looking at the history, I mean, that's sort of the vision of one guy, all of Vollstedt. And I mean, these guys laid these cars out in their garage and manufactured them. And you know, it's a one, maybe two guy, a guy operation. They bought a gearbox, they got an engine. They built everything else and they brought it here to the Speedway and they fitted it out. And driving around the Speedway in this thing, you remind yourself, I've got Dallara chassis number 73 that I run for Justin Wilson. I'm driving Vollstedt Ford 1. There is one, not 73, there's one. And it's truly a privilege.
You have, you and Justin have done some really good work this year. Does he have an appreciation not only for your personal and family history, but also an appreciation for you being able to go out and do something like this again on a Saturday when it's going to be his turn Sunday?
I really didn't sort of mention that. I think he's a little surprised. I showed up on Friday in a driver's suit, and he looked at me, what the hell, man? So relax, oh, I'm not after your job. But I explained to him what was going on, and he seemed genuinely excited.